Hi, I'm Graham Steele, Head of Product of the Cyber Group here in SandboxAQ, and today I'm joined by Stephen from our engineering team. So Stephen, am I right in understanding that you're a self-taught cryptographer based on your interest in cryptocurrency?
More or less. I was once very, very into cryptocurrencies and the coins and stuff, but then the more I look into it, the more I get obsessed and just attracted by the cryptography behind it, and the more I study into it, the less interest I actually have for the cryptocurrencies and the more about the cryptography. So yeah, I guess it kind of like gradually just picked up cryptography and security stuff kind of on the side. And yeah, well, here I am.
Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. Well, thanks for joining us today. So I want to talk to you about some work you've been doing recently on something we're calling cryptographic key sprawl. So what is cryptographic key sprawl and why should I care about it?
Yeah, sure. So it's actually something I've been kind of looking or thinking for a while because actually a few years ago, there was a similar problem called that. It's actually called secret sprawl. Mm-hmm. And what a secret sprawl is essentially you have all different kinds of digital systems and applications around, and usually you need to have access tokens and stuff in order to be able to authenticate into those systems.
Right.
However, you have all kinds of machines around, and you want to essentially, in order to access them, you have to put these access keys or secret keys everywhere. Like, mm-hmm. I want your laptop be able to access that system. Yeah. I want my laptop be able to do that as well. Mm-hmm. And also some other machine might need to do that on its own. And hence, you will have all of these kind of access tokens lying around everywhere. And in case if something leaks, yeah. And all of a sudden you have a security problem. Mm. And so how that's being fixed is through centralization. So right. we build these kind of key vaults or key stores that we centralize the management of all of these things, such that every time you need to ask for a token, you actually go ask for it. You ask a centralized entity to give you an access key to enable to access something.
Right. Right.
However, some new pattern I've been noticing lately, mm-hmm. is just like what you mentioned, the cryptographic key sprawl problem, mm-hmm. is actually a little bit more than just a secret sprawl problem. Okay. So secret sprawl, we're talking about symmetric secrets and access API tokens, access keys. But there are also another fundamental type of essentially cryptographic objects on our systems. These are asymmetric keys. Mm-hmm. So for example, there are like the elliptic curve keys, the RSA keys, and they just like if you open up like it, on your computer, they're actually present. They're around everywhere. Mm-hmm. And some of the examples is, for example, if you ever have certificates or X509 certificates, you will have a key that backs up that certificate, because the only way for you to prove that you own this certificate is if you own the private key and you're able to issue a signature
right.
about it. Mm-hmm. And so that's one example. The other example is if you ever use SSH to securely access your remote or production systems, your SSH keys are just sitting on your computers. And normally,
they're asymmetric keys as well.
They are asymmetric key as well, absolutely. And then whenever you create that, normally you looked up how you create SSH keys, and online Google will tell you, well, you run SSH keygen, which mm-hmm. will generate a key pair on your laptop. Again, for personal use, it's probably fine. But if you look at that problem from an enterprise point of view, you immediately see that every single person's laptop or device will have these kind of keys just lying around. Mm-hmm. And you have no idea when they generate those keys, how often they've been using those keys, or whether they have, like, how securely they are storing those keys.
Right.
And essentially, that suddenly becomes a huge management problem. And what if some of those keys accidentally got leaked out? What's the potential impact? What are some of the potential implications of those? It's very hard to track. And then that's kind of what I call like the cryptographic key sprawl problem.
Awesome. Yeah, right. I mean, this really keys into things that we hear about on the ground when we talk to, you know, CISO teams in our kind of customer base. This, I mean, often they're aware of SSH keys as like a real pain point for a lot of people. But I think this is quite interesting, kind of characterizing this as part of a kind of overall problem of cryptographic key sprawl. So one thing I was really interested in your work was this taxonomy you're proposing of how we can understand like the different states I'm in.
I can maybe elaborate a little bit more on the introduction of the taxonomy. Mm-hmm. So essentially, after kind of coming up with this kind of cryptographic key sprawl problem, I start thinking of how do we actually categorize? Like if you walk into an enterprise, there's probably like millions of keys around. There are keys provided like SSH keys, there are your TLS keys, there are keys that are provided by your MDMs, like stored in your operating systems, keychains, or actually some keys are actually being generated under the hood that you are never aware of. There are so many keys, and how do you actually track and how do you actually identify and categorize those keys? And then that's when I started thinking of maybe it would be nice to put some kind of taxonomy or leveling to these things.
Yeah.
So far, what I've been able to come up with is when you walk into a enterprise, and normally, if you don't manage anything, if you don't track anything, you're at level zero. Mm-hmm. That's what I call. And level zero is what I call sprawl. And essentially, you'll be having keys lying around everywhere, people provisioning and generating ad hoc key pairs, and they'll just be kind of all over the place.
Copying and pasting files, just copying them anywhere, whatever.
Exactly. And then you will have either no understandings of where those keys are, which happens sometimes, but most of the times you will have some understandings of those keys because those keys that will have to get used, and there will be some systems that more or less tracks a subset of those keys.
Uh-huh.
So think about like if your GitHub, you might have GitHub might actually track some of your trusted SSH keys.
Mm-hmm.
So you have a measure to know that these are your keys, but those information are heavily siloed. There's
right.
no way to actually consolidate them together, and there's no like global holistic views for like CISOs or for security teams to look at what are everything, like how do we actually piece together all the pieces of information so we can have a holistic view of the world.
Right. So what are the levels then? Talk us through the levels of the taxonomy.
Yeah, sure. So level zero is sprawl. And then level one is what I call tracked. So essentially, that's when you start tracking and mapping all those keys and understanding essentially more information about those keys. And level two is what I call managed. And that's essentially when we actually, on top of tracking, we started to actually control some aspects of those keys from a centralized way. And ultimately, there is an ultimate goal, which there will be a level three, which is something I would call either abstracted or isolated. And that's essentially what I think is might be the holy grail of all of this, is essentially the keys themselves, they no longer actually present themselves as just the raw key pairs, but instead they're really just a handle or an abstraction to another system that actually handles that for you. And in that case, you can be truly decoupled from all those burdens of managing keys yourself, and you can have other things manage them for you. So those are kind of the taxonomies.
Right, awesome, interesting. So let's say I'm in the kind of, well, the situation you described where I'm like mostly sprawl, right? I've mostly got just, and maybe I've got a few track keys, like you mentioned, if I'm using, GitHub or whatever it is, I've pasted a key there, then the GitHub knows I have this key, so I've got a little bit of tracking. How do I get towards the promised land of the kind of managed and then maybe abstracted keys?
So the way I see how to solve this problem, well, is first, we have to understand, like we have to like essentially slot these keys into these levels that I have just defined. Mm-hmm. And then we have to think in a bit more systematic approach. Well, to begin with, all the keys will be in a combination state of level zero and level one, because you either don't manage them at all, or you manage them somewhat. So you have to connect those informations into some place. So think of some potential integrations you have to do, or some kind of additional scanning, or some kind of inventory work you have to do to piece together all the informations you have from silo system to build up that one centralized cryptographic inventory you have. So that's just a crucial step to get from level zero to level one. And it is in my belief that we should aim to move all the level zero keys at least into level one, so we know where they are. Or at least even if we don't know like those keys, at least we know here are the potential sources where we can see those keys. So at least we'll have a good understanding of where we can expect these cryptographic keys to be. And from level one to level two, it's actually going to be a little bit more involved because, well, at level one, I would assume you will actually know what are those keys, where do they live, and how are they being used. So these are kind of like three critical questions, and we might not be able to answer all of them because through a simple scan, you might only know where those keys are, but if you might have to have continuous scans or other ways of integration to know actually about how frequently they're being used and what applications are using them, essentially more metadata to back this information. going to the next step, if we forget about the levels a little bit, if we know what are the keys, where they are, and how are they being used, the next question we should think is, what keys should we have, and where should they live, and how should they be used? So essentially, it's kind of thinking of essentially from observation to some kind of expectation. Mm. And then this kind of suggests we need to have some kind of unified policy language. To actually define these expectations, because in order to actually do anything meaningful, we have to first define what that thing is. So I would expect some kind of unified policy language to be able to capture all of these things and all of our expectations into that language. And ultimately, once we have that language, then we have to build the enforcement tools, the actuators that actually make sure the keys are, these devices will actually have these keys. Those keys will be stored in certain places, and then they will only be able to be used by certain users or applications. So that's kind of like how we gradually transition from level 1 to level 2, and ultimately from level 2 to level 3. To summarize, it will be integrations, and integrations and all the scanning and all the inventory work for us to get from level 0 to level 1. And then we have to do a lot of the more rigorous policy definition work to get us kind of like more better expectations on level 1. And then we have to build out all of those integrations, the enforcement, and all the actuators for us to get from level 1 to level 2 and 3.
Cool, great. All right. Awesome. So if you want to find out a bit more about how we are building ActiveGuard here at SandboxAQ to help organizations make their journey from untracked key sprawl to managed keys, there'll be a link under the video. If you've enjoyed the video, don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss a video here on the SandboxAQ YouTube channel. And just remains for me to say thank you very much, Stephen.
Yeah, no problem.